A very warm welcome to everybody. My name is Julie Albrecht. I'm director of the Bali. I'm very, very happy that you're here. A warm welcome to all the viewers at home who are not here because it's booked out, it's full. And a very warm welcome to our speakers and to the mayor of Amsterdam. It's a great honor to have you here. And a very warm welcome to Mohamedou Old Slahi, who's not here and who's somewhere in another part of the world and will join our conversation later this evening. I would say it's a rather great irony that we try to organize something in the capital of free speech, which we've been planning for more than half a year, and our bureaucracy is not able to get somebody here who has a very, very important message to tell and has lived through a very difficult life and has become wise, maybe. He was already always wise, or maybe he became wise of his experiences. But it's an outcry that we can't be able to get somebody like that to a free speech and a free thought event in the capital of free speech and free thought, Amsterdam. Thank you very much, Ian Day. We have been trying for half a year to get Mohamedou Old Slahi here, who's been in prison for 14 years without trial, unjustly. The United States imprisoned him and said, sorry, we are wrong for 14 years, and now somebody has to wait another half year on the bureaucracy of the Dutch, of the Netherlands, in order to not be able to come here and tell his story. I'm terribly sorry, I'm really terribly sorry. We tried the Noord-Nederlands Toneel, NNT, Knight, and Club Guy and Rooney to get a residency for him. We organized it in order to be able to work with him, to make theater, to make a theater tour, to make a dance. He wrote a dance performance, the text for a dance performance, which Knight performed. He couldn't be there at the premiere. He can't be here tonight at the opening of the festival. I'm just wondering, a country which actually joined the United States in what they called, with Orwellian newspeak, the extraordinary rendition. We, the Dutch, transported people in Guantanamo Bay to places in the world where they could be tortured. I wonder, you know, can't we just have the decency to have somebody who lived through these sort of things to tell us about his experiences, to tell about the idea of reconciliation? I'm really, really, really fed up with our bureaucracy. I'm not fed up with the mayor of Amsterdam. I'm really, really, really impressed. About her help, about the whole idea of organizing for a few years. This is the first kickoff of something which we will call het Vrijdenkers Festival. We will do up until 2025, when Amsterdam is existing 750 years. And I'm really touched by the fact that one of the major parts of this celebration will be also the idea of free thinking and Amsterdam as a city which provides help with free thinkers. And it's amazing because I think the municipal council, it just came out today, it will be, you can buy it from tomorrow onwards, the council of Amsterdam, the city council of Amsterdam, 12 of the members of the 45 city council from all parties, from extreme left to extreme right, from the Muslim party Denk to the liberals, wrote a part of this booklet, which is under, we helped them do it. It's called Think Free, Denk Vrij. 11 volksvertegenwoordigers of an Amsterdamse traditie. I don't know any other municipality in the world, actually, who managed to organize among themselves all the differences they have to write a booklet like this. Tomorrow we will talk about this later on in the year as well. I'm really amazed by the courage of the Amsterdam Municipal Council to do these sort of things and being able to do that. This is all the opening of the Free Thinkers Festival. We have more works of art. We have one work of art outside by Chan Dundar, his prison cell, and do have a look at it. It's an amazing conversation piece and work of art of his cell where he actually lived in. He was here yesterday evening to talk. He's here tonight, and he will be here tomorrow as well. This piece of art by Sarah van Sonsbeek It's the translation of the famous poem, the Dutch poem, Een volk dat voortgaan aan zwicht, to yield to a dictator's might, made by Sarah van Sonsbeek and Marlijn Geurts. Translated into different languages by different people. One of them is Mazi Alinejad, another is Chandundar, the Belarus Three Theater, and I'm forgetting somebody actually. I will come to it in a moment. We have also special requests like these art pieces of art. Mariam Namazier, would you please stand up for one moment? A very good friend of the Bali. I have a request for you because she will be collecting postcards from Amsterdam, which we bought, and we'll be outside at the end of. You can write something a little bit. Maybe you can, if you feel like it, for the atheist blogger from Iran, Sohail Arabi, who has went into hunger strike on 17 October. You can write a postcard to him to sustain him. Mariam will be sitting outside at the end of the happening. His mother has just been called in Iran to a sentence for 18 months for standing up to her son. Arabi won the Reporters Without Borders Press Freedom Award in 2017. He's been in prison for years. So if you feel like writing a postcard from Amsterdam, Mariam will be sitting outside. The program for tonight is the following. There's a welcome and opening speech of the mayor, Femke Halsema, and then we will be talking to Mazi Alinejad and we will be talking to Mohamedou Oltslahi, though online, like I just explained. But I first like to give the floor to the mayor of Amsterdam and hope we give her a warm, warm welcome, Femke Halsema.
Well, Yuri, thank you so very much, dear guests and dear digital guests. Let me start by extending the apology Yuri already made to you that I'm very sorry that you're not with us. And I would have loved to have a lively debate in person with you. So maybe next time. I hope next time. All right. Today, it's exactly 6 months ago that the Amsterdam writer and freethinker Hafid Bouazza died at the age of 51. When he moved to our city, aged 17, he experienced, as he said, a sense of recognition and homecoming. He writes, "I cannot describe the sensation in any other way than as a sensation of freedom." That same yearning of freedom did make him avoid our trams, because he felt distrust of vehicles that always follow the same line. His death would have been reason enough to organize a festival dedicated to free thinkers, but the urge for these days was another. Just 1 year ago, the French history teacher Samuel Paty was murdered after showing cartoons of the Prophet Muhammad during a lesson on the freedom of religion and expression. Shortly afterwards, a Dutch teacher who had followed Paty's example received threats. Muslims who had spoken out against the cartoons also received death threats. All this led to great fury, and rightly so. Satire and mockery are essential parts of a free and democratic society. In particular, the mockery of religious leaders and worldly rulers. It dethrones them and makes them one of us, fallible, vulnerable, and sometimes laughable. If we cannot ridicule power and criticize it openly, free thought is finished. Nor can free thought survive if believers of any religion are humiliated, intimidated, or threatened. Amsterdam City Council, as was already mentioned by Yuri, held an intense debate on this. And this debate resulted in a motion calling on the council to organize talks in the city about freedom of speech and freedom of religion. A wonderful idea. These conversations should ignite the fire of freedom in as many people as possible. Certainly, they should not be sanctimonious. Dutiful speeches only uttered at a stage somewhere in City Hall. No. When it comes to this subject, we need speakers who know what is at stake when we talk about freedom. We need stories by free spirits that catch us off guard. Painful truths that put our self-proclaimed love of free speech to the test. And who better to organize this than the Bali? Using suggestions from free spirits in the city council, they developed this festival of free thinkers. It is no coincidence that it takes place 2 days after we have celebrated the 746th anniversary of our city. The promise of freedom is an essential part of our city. And in the run-up to Amsterdam's 750th birthday, we will continue to underline this frequently and urgently. Because freedom needs ongoing care. We are reminded of this not only by the stories of the international speakers here present. In our own city, the promise of freedom is too often unfulfilled. And it is just the new generations who are yearning for freedom, who are restricted in so many ways. If a Muslim woman wants to leave her faith or simply doesn't want to wear the hijab, she is called a whore, a whore, or worse. A Muslim woman who does choose to cover her hair is called a terrorist. Other girls and young women seem to have to choose between a culture in which sexual exploitation is normalized and a group morality in which choosing to wear anything revealing is just judged as asking for trouble. Ultra-conservative youth movements are intoxicated with conspiracy theories and a dream of a white Europe. While a puritanical trend in academia and cultural institutions forces people to choose between a mind-numbing safe space or being cancelled for life. Spinoza wrote, "It's not the purpose of politics to turn men from reasonable beings into animals, but on the contrary, to ensure that they may freely use reason and not struggle with hatred, wrath, and deceit, nor allow themselves to be swept away by bitter feelings towards one another." So it is also a misunderstanding that a free spirit must always express itself in the most confrontational way. Indeed, grand and stately institutions may collapse from a touch of irony rather than from the wrecking ball of strong words. The moral knight will sooner dismount his high horse for courtesy than for a curse. Distinguished guests, here and digital. As he grew older, Hafid Bouazza did sometimes take the tram. And he also acquired some regular walking routes, but as he put it, physical limitations can be expanded by the mind, by knowledge, and other delights. And he made an appeal to the city to grow in the latter respect. So that is what we are doing, or what we are going to do during our Free Thinkers Festival. A program full of courageous and eloquent free spirits. Once again, I would like to pay a huge compliment to our city council for the way in which it has embraced freedom of speech and religion. I would like to point out, as Yuri already did, to the audience that several council members from all parts of the political spectrum have written an essay on freedom, which is on sale from tomorrow afternoon. And I think that has been enough advertisement for now. I thank in advance all the speakers. And to those who have come specially to Amsterdam, sometimes putting up with difficult circumstances and bureaucratic opposition in so doing, I extend a warm welcome. Thank you all. Thank you for helping our city and society to embrace its core, freedom. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Femke Halsema, Mayor of Amsterdam.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your opening and for your wonderful words. I'm starting off with a conversation with Mazi Alinejad, and if you want to join in, you can. That's why I handed you the microphone. Please, Mazi Alinejad, can I ask you to maybe sit over there, to the more comfortable couch?
On my own or with?
With the microphone, sure. And the mayor on the first row, so she can join in if she wants, and the empty chair for Mohamedou Old Sly, who's online with us. But a short introduction. Activist, journalist, writer Mazi Alinejad founded a major movement for women around the world. She strives for equal rights for girls and women. Alinejad is, to my idea, an awe-inspiring journalist and activist. She started out in a small village in Iran, started a major world movement by the removal of her hijab that is compulsory in Iran. Her activism comes at great costs. It's not just something which comes for free. She's unable to visit her native country, to see her family, and she's being threatened on a daily basis and has to fear for her life because she's high on the hit list of the Iranian regime. She's been speaking out against the Iranian government's discriminatory policies for decades at a very high cost. It's wonderful that you're here.
Thank you for having me. You said everything except one thing that I wanted to hear. I'm a troublemaker for the oppressors, like millions of other Iranian women who are doing this on daily life.
Yes, and you have millions of followers on the internet, on your accounts, on your social media accounts. So your voice is heard, and your trouble—the trouble you make—is understood by a lot of people around the world. We're having a conference on the whole idea of speaking out, of being able to have your own thoughts, your own opinions, and being able to express them in the way you want it. You've been doing that, been living that for a long time. You've been exiled. You've been almost abdicated by the Iranian secret services. You've been. So the first question I'd like to ask you is how do you manage to stand alone against, you know, such powers?
First of all, I have to say that I'm not alone. Thank you. These days, it's a pleasure for me being here in Netherlands while I was told that by the FBI in America, don't go to Europe because you're not going to be safe. And I said that, wait a minute, I left my country to come here in the West to be safe. And instead of kicking out the terrorists, you're telling me not to go anywhere. And we are not welcome sometimes because of the issue is very sensitive. Many female politicians try to have the bond and link connection with the Islamic Republic. So that's why they say that touching about compulsory job is too sensitive. So thank you so much for organizing this event and inviting me to be with you. I see this as a support for all Iranian women who stand up for their belief and fight for freedom within the society. Thank you so much. And about me, that how I handle to to survive or to fight back the oppressors? This is not an easy question.
No.
But to be honest, for many, many times, I thought that, does it worth that what I have been experiencing, it's not new to me. It has been going on for 42 years, but I want to tell my story. So tomorrow be with me, I'm going to talk about Iranian women as well. When I grew up in a very, in a tiny village, in a very traditional family. So I started my own revolution from my family's kitchen because I had to fight with my relative as well to be my true self. That was not difficult, but immediately when I got, when I went to high school, then I got kicked out and I thought, okay, so I have to fight with everyone. The day when I left Iran, I thought that, okay, I got expelled from high school. I got expelled from Iranian parliament just because of exposing the corruption. I got expelled from Iran, but here in the West, I have the freedom to do whatever I want. But suddenly I found out that no, the Islamic Republic, the coronavirus is infecting the rest of the world. They are here to keep me silent, like millions of other, you know, people experience it inside Iran. But here I experience this every day. Like, first, they arrested the women who send videos to White Wednesday's campaign, which is a campaign where women peacefully walk with a white symbol, removing their hijab and saying no to compulsory hijab. They were arrested 29 women of campaign one day. So you feel guilty, you feel the burden on your shoulder. I said, I'm gonna just stop the campaign. Immediately, I found that the mothers of those people who got arrested, they sent video to me. Sabah Kordafshari is only 20 years old. She received 24 years prison sentence, more than her age. So I felt guilty and I said, I wanna get stopped. Then Rahele Ahmadi, her mother joined me. So that was the day I found that I'm gonna keep going. As far as the women of Iran is gonna do. This is how I handle my pressure. The day when the regime actually found out that they're not gonna stop this woman by arresting them, they actually made a different show about me saying that Masih was raped by three men. They were not even ashamed to say that I was raped by three men in London in front of my teenager son. Because in their mindset, if you're a woman and you got raped, it's your fault. Yeah. So, and then that didn't stop me. Then they made a new law saying that if anyone sent videos to Masih, we'll be charged up to 10 years prison. The day I was bombarded by videos from women who lost their beloved one, from mothers who lost their beloved one in Iran protest, holding a pictures, walking in the street and saying that my son got killed here, my daughter got killed here. This is I handle all the threat, all the pressure. I'm here, but these people are facing the true bullets. These mothers are actually Suhail Arabi, as you mentioned, that Maryam Namazi is helping his case, is only one example. So when these people are fighting the regime inside Iran, then why should I be scared? They give me hope to keep going.
Okay. So you're saying but I can see that, of course. But there's different things. First of all, being so fiercely able to dissent and to dissent in your opinions and take the consequences for it. Would you say, because you're saying, you know, I was kicked out of, I started in my kitchen with my family, would you say that, and that's difficult to say, of course, from yourself, but is it something which is always in your, has been in yourself, or were there moments where you really had to tell yourself, no, I need to be brave and dissenting?
I mean, I have to say that I learned from my pain to be powerful. You know, when you're poor, everyone discriminates against you. But for me, I grew up in a country where we experienced revolution, we experienced war, we experienced discrimination, we experienced being threatened from the age of 7. If you don't wear hijab, you will get kicked out from a school. So I often get this question, how you find this, how you learn
you
to
learned
be brave.
You learned from your pain, you're saying?
I said that I learned from my... Actually, I learned from my mother as well. My mom, she's a tiny woman. She's not even able to read and write. I remember that in my village, we didn't have running water. We didn't have electricity. We didn't have inside bathroom. We had to use the outhouse, which was in the backyard garden. So backyard garden was dark, blacker than black. It was scary as a young girl, 10-year-old girl. And I remember my mom used to tell me that if you wait for someone else to save you, you're not going to win anything. Be your own savior. Do your own work. So my mom taught me a lesson. She said that darkness is like a monster. If you're scared of the darkness will swallow you all, will devour you. But instead, if you open your eyes as wide as you can, the darkness will disappear. As a kid, I thought this was a fact, and I used to go to the outhouse opening my eyes as wide as I could. And I found that it worked. It worked. So I scared so many times. Even here in the West, I get scared of everything, but I open my eyes. And this is how I learned from my mom, who's not a feminist, who's not a, as I told you, she's not even able to read and write. Where I experience darkness, then I have to go and I have to fight with it. Instead of being a victim, I have to be a warrior. This is how I learned from my pain to be powerful.
But then there's many other things to ask, of course. But there's the thing you mentioned. Because other people are taking the risk. They're sending these videos to you. And you're taking the risk, as has been shown by the fact that the Iranian government wants to kill you or abdicate you. So I mean, let's not forget, it's you as well. But you're right in a way. Of course, it's a huge responsibility to, I mean, those people who are suppressed. I mean, it's very touching and very, very dramatic and sad. They take the risk to send videos to you. It's outlawed, 10 years of prison. In prison circumstances, which are not, you know, and you decide to put it on, that puts a lot of burden on you.
That's a very good question, and that's such a good way to ask this question. I'm going to be very honest with you. Very honest with you. Often I get this question with Western journalists that, don't you feel guilty that you put a lot of people in danger? You know that this is a crime, and now you're asking them to send you videos? Thank you so much that you didn't put the blame on us, because this is very heartbreaking to see that you're witnessing a regime in 21st century beating up people, lashing people, executing people for the crime of thinking, for the crime of wanting to choose what they want to wear. And then you leave the regime, you go to Iran, you obey compulsory hijab laws as a Western female journalist, and then you come to me and ask me that, don't you feel guilty? That you ask me, no. Those who lash us should feel guilty. Those who execute us should feel guilty. Those who actually ban me from hugging my mother should feel guilty. Those who put my brother in prison should feel guilty. Those who actually put the mother and daughter both together in prison right now that I'm talking to you should feel guilty. And those female politicians from Netherlands who goes to my beautiful country and say nothing about these discriminatory laws and they obey it and they bow the regime should feel guilty. My people in Iran, there are, how many Iranians are here? I know Maryam Namazi, before me she was an activist. How many Iranians are here now? So you know that. Iranian people, they are so brave enough to break the law every day. So when they risk their lives, they have a message. So simple, because they want to be heard. And we are not the only one in the history doing that. Women of suffrages, Rosa Parks. So imagine the journalists and Western politicians telling me that, don't you feel guilty? So imagine how they would analyze the fight from women of suffrages. We have so many women of suffrages in Iran. We have so many Rosa Parks of Iran. I want to just end this question with an example. When Iran protests happened, which is the second anniversary of Iran protests right now, the government shut down the internet for 3 days and they killed 1,500 people. 1,500 people in 3 days. And that time, I asked Mark Zuckerberg, I asked Jack Dorsey, my pronunciation is correct, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, that the government in Iran shut down the internet and they're killing people. And they have accounts on Twitter and Instagram. Kick them out. Why should they be... And I ask female politicians, I ask global feminist movement, I ask so many human rights organizations, please help me. I have to get your support because we have to kick the supreme leader of Iran and dictators out from social media. Guess what was their answer? We are supporting freedom of speech. We are not going to do that. I said that Taliban, ISIS, Islamic Republic, you supporting their freedom to spread violence through social media. At the same time, Federico Mogherini was in Iran and taking selfie with the Iranian officials.
Federica Mogherini is the high representative of the European Union.
On
foreign policy. Yeah.
I lost my allies outside the world, and I didn't know what to do. And I asked those. Then, when internet was like after I think 1 month, the mothers found out they can go to internet and spread their word. We, the Iranian people outside Iran, were all of us bombarded by videos, photos from mothers who were saying that when internet was shut down, my son got killed. One mother, Puya Bakhtiari, was a symbol of Iran protest. She came to me and she said that the same day when my son was killed, I was in the street with my son. We were both holding hands. We were protesting together. And the same day, my son in front of my eyes got killed. And I want you to spread my voice. I published her video. Again, I got this question from so many politicians and Western media and human rights organizations. Aren't you going to put her life in danger? So, and I asked her, and she told me that, just say this one. Ask a simple question to anyone in the West. Would you go and live in Iran under the law which do not give you to have a real election to vote for who you want to vote? Would you go and live under Sharia laws which actually kick you out from a school from the age of 7? If they say yes, tell them all come to Iran and live here. If they say no, tell them shut up. And don't, yes, honestly. I mean, normally I'm politically correct, but that was the message from a mother that if anyone said that, don't you feel guilty, tell them, okay, so you go to Iran and live under Sharia laws. And now the situation in Afghanistan as well. And I want to actually tell what I said in the opening, that I got bombarded from the women of Afghanistan as well the day when Taliban took over. And the women were brave, beautiful, amazing, sending videos to me. I was scared for them. And I told one of them that I'm going to blur your face, then I'm going to publish the video. And the woman said something, this is going to be the last sentence of this event maybe. She said that, you want to blur my face? This is what Taliban does to me. Don't. I'm actually using your platform to take my visibility back. So help me to be my true self. I did, and 2 days later, she was in front of the rally, and her picture was on Guardian, was on CNN, and was everywhere. So when you're allowing people to express themselves, they feel that they have agency, and they can be powerful to get other women on their side. So these women have their agency, and help them to be heard. That's all they want. I know I'm loud and I'm talkative. You can stop me anytime you want.
I know. I will if I think it's necessary. I'm not going to stop you if it's not helping our conversation.
Thank you.
The whole idea of what it is to stand out and to speak out and to be a dissenter. And I think you said many wonderful things, but one of them is very, I think, important for us. You not only protest against the regime in Iran, you have to battle the whole Western press in many ways as well, because and that's of course the same idea of dissenting, this wrong, putting the blame on you instead of where the blame belongs. Again, this is sort of very recommendable that you are able to point out, you know, where you dissent and how important it is. And we always think that we live in a free part of the world, though there is a thing like groupthink. There's a thing like blaming the victim, like they are blaming you. So I think that's a very important lesson for us, who are not living in Iran but living here, and pointing that out is again this sort of dissenting.
Exactly.
Way of looking at things. It's very beautiful. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's like telling a woman who got raped that it's your fault. Yeah. And we used to hear that in Iran. That, I mean, even the Green, when the Me Too movement happened, I remember the Supreme Leader of Iran was saying that, oh, this is, he made a video, he shared it on Twitter, which is banned for Iranian people, and he said that it's the Western women's fault. Because they don't know Islam and they don't wear compulsory hijab, so that's why they get raped every day. So they put the blame on, and I said, wait a minute, in Iran, women get raped, but if they go to the court, it's their fault. Because first they have to prove that they were fully covered. That's why I created a hashtag called My Camera is My Weapon. It means that if we cannot make an official complaint, just embarrass your harassers in public, use your camera and film them. That's the way that's the way our Me Too movement works in Iran.
Our Me Too movement, yeah. That's a wonderful way of putting it. I'm wondering whether we have another guest. We will continue a conversation in a moment with Mohamedou Oltslahi. But before that, there might be people who want to join in, want to ask a question, maybe the I gave the mayor a microphone. Maybe she has something to say.
I think the mayor changed her mind. She's not going to invite me anymore. I'm so too critical of the Western.
I'm just listening. It's your moment to shine. So and it's really it's so courageous and you're so wonderful and so humanistic. So well, I'm proud that you're here. Really proud.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Any questions? Gatol has a. You have a microphone, Gatol, or? Oh. The woman in the red attire. Yeah.
Hi. I would like to know, as a journalist, you are living in America now, and you are almost like a bridge between. The West and the East. But sometimes there is fake news from the Iranian government or from the Arabic countries about a woman's situation. And sometimes it's the opposite from Western media. They always somehow publish all these mainstream ideas about women. And do you find sometimes fake news, and how do you deal with it? Do you call the magazine to fix it? Does it make you angry? For example, Al Jazeera published article about Muslim women feel that coronavirus gives them dignity because everybody has to wear mask, like everybody wear a niqab. And that's in Arabic, actually. They didn't translate it into Al Jazeera English. So I was furious when I read this.
I feel your pain.
Yes. So what is your solution when you see some kind of this news?
Yeah. That's a very, very good question. Where are you from?
I'm from Syria.
That's why you ask this question, because we all share this pain from Syria, from my brother, from Turkey. We lost the narrative in the West, and we have to be clear and loud about it. How we lost the narrative. For many, many times when I was actually challenging compulsory hijab laws, I keep hearing from the media in the West. New York Times wrote an article and said that compulsory hijab is a cultural issue and Western feminists and Western athletes should not touch the issue because it's a cultural issue. And when I was fighting and saying that, like, women and men are separated and they have, like, we have, like, only female park in Iran. We do. Can you... We do have. Just, like, women should be separated in one park and we have this kind of park in Iran. And then well-known journalist works for reliable media, tweeting and saying that, no, we never had this. When women get beaten up in the street, we saw that in one of the reliable media in the West saying that from now on, police is not going to arrest women. They're going to send them to educational course. And another thing, for 42 years, women are fighting to enter a stadium. And 2 years ago, one of the women actually dressed like a boy. She entered a stadium, she got arrested, and she was sentenced to go to prison for 6 years. So she couldn't handle it. So she set herself on fire and she killed herself. And because of the pressure, we women launched a campaign. All of us, we got together from Iran to let the FIFA know that if you really care about equality, this is the time. Boycott Iran until the day when they allow Iranian women to enter a stadium. Guess what? The headline of all the Western media was, finally, women are allowed to go to a stadium. Why? Because the government know the scandal, know the pressure, so they allow a few women to go there, they make pictures, and they send it to the media, and the media publish it. And Christian Amanpour, who was my role model, was actually telling Javad Zarif that that's progress. And her face made me like furious. Why you say this is progress? Because this is a big lie. Yes, sister, I get furious, but my tactic, just being furious is not gonna work. You have to ask every single, this is my idea. They can go after activists in Iran and arrest them. They can shut down the newspaper in Iran. They can have their own lobbyists outside Iran. They can have their own mouse pith in the media inside Iran. But if you make every single person to be a movement, to be a storyteller, to be their own media, nobody can go after every single person. Social media is our weapon. So ask every single woman, go in front of the stadium, make a video. If they say that mask is for the dignity of women, ask every single woman in Syria to speak up. The day when Javad Zarif and Rouhani was on CNN, there was an ordinary woman standing next to her husband. Her husband wore hijab. The woman was on way. And they were saying that we oppose compulsory hijab, that the men were said, yes, I don't own my wife, why should I wear hijab? That video got 11 million views, more than the supreme leader of Iran. That's how we can win the battle. I myself have 7 million followers, I'm not a model, I'm not an actor. This platform is the voice of ordinary people. And that shows the power of us, and we can win the battle if we all, every individual person, feel the responsibility to speak up. We're gonna win the dictators and their fake news in the West. This is my way.
Thank you. There's one more, there's room for one more question from the woman also in the red. That's wonderful, sitting over there.
Yeah. Hi, respect, thank you very much. Now you've been living so long in the West, I just want to ask you, what do you think from everything you've experienced? Do we here really make use out of thinking freely? Not speaking freely, but really thinking freely in the West about our own issues?
I really didn't get the question. What do I think about the Western policy towards...
Free thinking, you know, I was just somehow, you know, free thinking. We somehow assume that's what's happening here. No one doubts it here that we think freely. Yes, we have a right to speak freely. But thinking freely, I regularly doubt. So what's your experience from everything you've
Are we making use of the fact that we are
right or privilege?
I mean, I'm going to be honest. Look at what's going on in Afghanistan. This is a betrayal. If we really if we really think freely in the West, we should all be in the street now and think about this. Many people say that, okay, this is very far from our bed, from our house, from our life, and Taliban is like, you know, this is not our issue in the West. I think West is wrong of thinking that way, that like separating human rights from like any kind of deal they're gonna have with in the Middle East, or like saying that we have to leave the internal matter behind and we should not touch the issue. This is how West failed, because I strongly believe that if like we are free thinkers here in the West, if we all really care about human rights, then we have to accept as human rights as a global issue. And as I said that before, what happened in Vegas, everyone says that it's gonna stay in the Vegas. But what happens in the Middle East doesn't gonna stay in the Middle East. If we don't fight, if we don't support the fight of the women in Afghanistan and in the Middle East, in Iran, many other countries, then we have to deal with Taliban, ISIS, and Islamic Republic in the West as well. This is, I think, this is very wrong. Many global feminist movement, I see them, I meet with them, I appreciate many of them are supportive, but many of them say that, you know, because of white savior complex, we don't want to like support, we don't, not support, we don't want to interfere to internal matter in Iran. Let them deal with it. We don't want to save them. This is wrong narrative, and many left and liberals, they left, you know, I think they lost, and they left their sisters in Iran and Afghanistan. If I got your question right, I think that we need even here to educate ourselves, that if we have freedom, and if we are free thinkers here, then we have to see human rights, and especially women's rights, like a global issue.
Thank you very much. Yeah. I'm gonna move on to the next part of our program. Thank you very much. You're here tomorrow as well. So if you want to hear more of those encouraging words and interesting free thinking, please do come back tomorrow.
Thank you so much, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
We have another speaker who's not here, but who's here. I've been looking at Mohammadou Oltslahi on that screen. We will move the screen from there to here. And in the meantime, I'm going to announce Jochem ten Haaf, who is a famous actor who we're lucky enough to work often with. Very welcome to you, Jochem. And we asked Jochem to read two passages from, as an intermezzo between those two conversations, two passages from the book The Sunflower, which was published in 1969, a book by Simon Wiesenthal, who has been a victim of the Holocaust, and his describes in the book. The book is about forgiveness, about how you forgive and who should forgive and who you can forgive. I think it's a wonderful book because he asked the same. He was asked by an SS, dying SS soldier, to forgive him, and he refused to give him forgiveness, and he struggled with that that moment for the rest of his life, and he asked many, many people what they thought about that, that he could not forgive this SS soldier, although he was dying and repenting. And he said to himself, I cannot forgive the deeds of these SS men because they weren't done to me. So I cannot forgive it. And he posed that question to many people over the years, to the Dalai Lama, to many rabbis and priests and intellectuals. And I think it's a very, very interesting book. We chose two passages, whose Jochem is going to read out. Of course, a passage of somebody who agrees with him and somebody who disagrees with Simon Wiesenthal. And then we move on in the conversation to Mohammadou Oltslahi. Jochem ten Haaf.
Thank you. Only Josek stayed with me. Do you know, Josek began, when you were telling us about your meeting with this SS man, I feared at first that you had really forgiven him. You would have had no right to do so in the name of people who had not authorized you to do so. What people have done to you yourself, you can, if you like, forgive and forget. That's your own affair. But it would have been a terrible sin to burden your conscience with other people's sufferings. But, continues Simon, aren't we a single community with the same destiny, and one must answer for the other? Be careful, my friend, continued Josek. In each person's life, there are historic moments which rarely occur, and today you have experienced one such. It is not a simple problem for you. I can see you are not entirely pleased with yourself, but I assure you that I would have done the same as you did. The only difference, perhaps, is that I would have refused my pardon quite deliberately and openly, and yet with a clear conscience. You act more unconsciously. And now you don't know whether it was right or wrong, but believe me, it was right. You have suffered nothing because of this man, and it follows that what he has done to other people, you are in no position to forgive. Josek's face was transfigured. I believe, he continued, in life after death, in another better world, where we will all meet again after we are dead. How would it seem then if you had forgiven him? Would not the dead people from the camp come to you and ask, who gave you the right to forgive our murderer? I shook my head thoughtfully. Josek, I said, you make it all sound so simple, probably because your faith is strong. I could argue with you for hours, although I would not want to alter my actions, even if I could. I will only say one thing, and I'm anxious to know what you think. This fellow, this SS man, he showed a deep and genuine repentance. He did not once try to excuse what he had done. And I saw that he was really in torment. Josek interrupted me. Such torment is only a small part of his punishment. But, I continued, he has no time left to repent or atone for his crimes. What do you mean by atone for? Josek continued. He now had me where he wanted me. I had no reply. I dropped the argument and I tried another gambit. This dying man, this SS officer, looked on me as a representative, as a symbol of the other Jews whom he could no longer reach or talk to. And moreover, he showed his repentance entirely of his own accord. Obviously, he was not born a murderer, nor did he want to be a murderer. It was the Nazis who made him kill defenseless people. Oh, so you mean you ought to have forgiven him after all? At this juncture, Arthur, another friend, came back. He had heard only Josek's last sentence, and in his usual quiet voice, he said, a superman has asked a subhuman to do something which is superhuman. Had you forgiven him, you would never have forgiven yourself all your life. It's the first debate. Second debate. Yes. Bolek. Some minutes passed in silence, although Bolek's Catholic priest, his eyes never left mine. He too seemed to have forgotten time and place. I don't think that the attitude of the great religions to the question of forgiveness differs to any great extent. If there is any difference, then it is more in practice than in principle. One thing is certain, you can only forgive a wrong that has been done to yourself. Yet, on the other hand, whom had this SS man to turn to? None of those he had wronged were still alive. I said. So he asked something from me that was impossible to grant. Well, probably he turned to you because he regarded Jews as a single condemned community. For him, you were a member of this community and thus his last chance. What Bolek was saying reminded me of the feeling I experienced during the dying man's confession. At that time, I really was his last chance of receiving absolution. I had tried to express this view when discussing the affair with Josek, but he managed to convince me otherwise at the time. Or was it illusion? But Bolek continued, I don't think he was lying to you. When one is face to face with death, one doesn't lie. On his deathbed, he apparently returned to the faith of his childhood, and he died in peace because you listened to his confession. It was a real confession for him, even without a priest. Through his confession, as you surely know, though it was not a formal confession, his conscience was liberated and he died in peace because you had listened to him. He had regained his faith. He had become once again the boy who, as you said, was in close relation with his church. "Well, you seem to be all on his side," I protested. "Very few SS men were brought up as atheists, but none retained any teaching of their church." "Well, that's not the question," Bole continued. "I thought a lot about this problem when I was in Auschwitz. I argued with the Jews there. And if I survive this camp and ever get ordained as a priest, then I must reconsider what I have said about the Jews. You are aware that the Polish church in particular was always very anti-Semitic. But let us stick to your problem. So this Lemberg, this SS fellow, showed signs of repentance. Genuine, sincere repentance for his misdeeds. That at least is how you described it." "Yes," I answered, "and I'm still convinced of that." "Then," Bolek pronounced solemnly, "then he deserved the mercy of forgiveness." Thank you.
Amadou Oldslaai, thank you very much, Jochem ten Haaf, for reading out Simon Wiesenthal's, parts of Simon Wiesenthal's books. Mohamedou, who has been following us from afar online, for 14 years, the Mauritanian Oldslaai was imprisoned in Guantanamo Bay, without ever setting one foot in court, without being indicted. Oldslaai was accused of being involved in the 9/11 attacks, and in prison he was tortured, humiliated by American prison guards. In 2015, while still being held at Guantanamo Bay, his book Guantanamo Diary came out, which in which he describes his experiences in prison. It's an impressive book. I can recommend it to you. In 2016, he was released without ever having been trialed or indicted, with a meager excuse from the American authorities. He moves back to Mauritania, where he lives now, and his book was made into a major Hollywood production. You can see it. You can see it online. It has been shown here in Amsterdam in theaters as well. You can see the Mauritanian, impressive movie, also with Jodie Foster in it and David Cumberbatch. It's the story of his life. We tried to set up a artist in residency together with Knight, with NNT, Club Guy and Rooney, which is the Noord-Nederlands Toneel, and they made Mohamedou Oldslaai and the NNT made a wonderful a dance performance out of his texts. We were planning to do a whole series of lectures here going through this country on repentance, on forgiveness, on his experiences, which obviously we started out in May, but after the ENA got all the the papers, and even more absurd, the Arbeidsbureau looked into the fact whether he could work here, because maybe we could find, maybe he was, you know, there were probably many other people who have been unjustly imprisoned for 14 years, and we could maybe find some Dutchman to do this with. Surprisingly, there wasn't any Dutchman of that, so after 3 months of deliberation, the Arbeidsbureau decided that no, there wasn't any other person who could have possibly, you know, do these tour. So we set up this artist in residence. We're sure we're going to do that. We're just wondering when. So this is again what it is. If you talk about free speech, you have to go through internet, and you have to be, as a Dutch citizen, being really ashamed of yourself. Welcome very, very much, Mohamedou. We've been talking on the internet for quite a while, and here we are again talking to each other on the internet. Welcome, warm welcome to you, though you're not here. I was going to ask you, Mohamedou, you for 14 years you were imprisoned. You were tortured. How on earth could you find the strength to remain your sanity and your own judgment and being able to have your own opinions and your own... Just the same question I asked a few moments ago to Mazi Alinejad. Yeah, how did you manage to do that?
Goedenavond, dames en heren. Dank u wel, burgemeester Femke Hersema. Dank je wel, mijn broer Juri Albrecht. En Jante, and thank you my co-panelists, Joachim and Ali Nejad. The thing that I most would like to say now is Ik hou van de Nederland. So, very few people in this world have had the chance to face death and live a second life. I am one of those, so, and I tell you why. I remember vividly this day. It was July 21st. 2002, and I was taken like out of a grave from my Jordanian cell. Jordan was my first black site, and I spent 8 months, and I cannot describe to you like how much pain and suffering I experience. Most of the pain was emanating from two facts. The fact that my own people, you know, were used to visit harm and pain upon me. The second thing, like hearing the other people being tortured, because those were sessions where I was forced, taken out to listen to people being tortured. That was much worse than when they beat me. They did not beat me a lot. As a matter of fact, I remember only two times when they assaulted me physically. And they came to my cell. They said, "You're going home," after 8 months. I started crying because I didn't know what freedom, man. I hated my face. I didn't want to see my face. And I was not allowed to see my face. I don't know why, but in black side, you are not allowed to see your face in a mirror. And this was good, because I didn't want to see my face. And so they took me out, and they gave me back my portemonnaie. I remember what I had. I think I had about $80, and I had a German Führerschein driver license. I had Canadian driver license, and they had my passport outside the portemonnaie, and I had some change. They gave me that, and they said you should sign that you got your things back. And I was like thinking, okay, and if you don't give them to me, you think I'm going not to sign? But I said that in my head. I didn't tell them anything because I was very scared. I was shaking like this, signing. And I saw the date. The date was 21st of July. But in my head, the date was 31st of July. I don't know how I lost 10 days. I lost the count because I didn't know a lot of the time when it was night or day. And I really don't know why I lost it, because I kept like counting every single day. So they put me in that truck blindfolded, earmuffed, and they took me to the airport. I remember they put the music. I remember the artist, Abdel Halim Hafez, my favorite, one of my favorite, from Egypt. And then I was enjoying the music because they put it to dumb down the noises so that I couldn't hear their calls, you know, and operation. But it was okay. I'd rather hear Abdel Halim Hafez than hear some spook. So, and I stayed there. I wanted so bad to the bathroom, so bad. But I kept it. And I would keep it for 7 more hours. It was so painful. And then people started to touch me everywhere. And they cut my clothes and they stripped me naked. They put diaper, baby's diaper around. And then one of them like removed the blindfold to see my eyes. He was kind some kind of doctors, and I saw his arms. It was blonde hair. I had my suspicion, but now it was confirmed. I wasn't going home. This was a ruse. I was being again kidnapped to another place. And it occurred to me that I'm going to be taken to an American prison and I will die, sentenced to death, or just put there until I die. And I knew from the documentaries I saw during my time in Europe, in Germany, I wasn't far from the Netherlands. Venlo was only 40 kilometers away from me. And I remember like those horrible like treatment of prisoners. Those are American prisoners now. And I was really in a bad position. I did not speak English, numero uno. And two, I was Arab. They perceived me as Arab, whatever that means. That bad. I was African. Bad, very bad. I was Muslim, very bad. So I had no chance. And then I knew that was the end of life. And I started to regret stuff. I tell you what I did not regret. I did not regret not having money. I did not regret not having Swiss account. I did not regret not having those beautiful girls that were not interested in me. I did not regret them. And I regretted one thing. I wished I was nicer, you know? And I regretted every bad comment I made to people, to my mother, to my brothers, to my sisters, to my friend, to my ex. And I took it upon myself to be, and I made a vow of kindness. I want to be kind no matter what. And that's, my brother, why it's so easy for me to free myself and forgive people, because I can only be kind, because that's the only thing that matters to me in my life. Very long answer.
No, I mean, a long answer, but not, I mean, not at all long. I mean, a very difficult answer, because I think if I, and I tried for, we've been in contact for more than half a year, and I read your book, and I tried to imagine, you know, I would be so full of anger. I would be so full of anger. I'm already angered by the fact that my government can't, you know, get their act together to acknowledge the fact that you have the right to, you know, travel the world, you know. So I would be smothered in rage, because you're describing 8 months in a prison in Jordania, but that was just, you know, there were 13 more years to come after that. I mean, it's difficult for me to understand. I mean, if I look at my own psychological makeup.
I absolutely understand your point of view, but I could challenge this question and put it in a different way. Mm-hmm. What matters to you? Does it matter to you to see Richard Zuli and Mr. X suffer in their life? Or does it matter to you to live in peace in your heart? I do remember vividly the day that I was kidnapped from my house. I was only with my mother.
In Mauritania, yeah.
Mauritania.
Yeah.
And this is not the Netherlands where the police come to you and said, we arrest you. There is an arrest warrant. No. This is the leader of the free world, the United States of America, the most powerful country in the world on recorded history, calling my president, say, arrest Muhammadu and ship him to Jordan. They come to me, no arrest warrant. I remember my mother praying frantically with her prayer beads, and I watched her from the rearview mirror until she disappeared. I never saw her again. In the honor of my mother, I cannot describe to the pain when they came to me, they said, your mother passed away. It was so much burning in my heart. I had to stand up and recite the Quran for about 10 hours because I want to punish my body so I could rest. I could like make up for the fire, burning fire. And in honor of her memory, I have to forgive those people who hurt me and hurt her because this is really peace. Because when I forgive, I go back and laugh and long, you know? And I do nothing because I have a vow of doing nothing too. Because I want to do nothing. We are now in Netherlands and we have the freedom to do freaking nothing. I just lie down and smile and happy.
But some people are actually there are actually Muhammadu, there are people crying here on the front row, and I almost there. I'm not joking. There are people here who take your words to heart and think they're hard to swallow from a personal point of view. So thank you. If I can come to the question of the fragments, the fragments, because I choose the fragments of Simon Wiesenthal also because we are part of what has been done to you. So in a way, I'm in the position of the man who's asking for forgiveness to Simon Wiesenthal. Because the Netherlands has been part and partial of the war against terror and of the extraordinary renditions, they're called, you know, of people like yourself who've been brought to places where they're tortured. Our government, and I'm a taxpayer and a passport-carrying member of the Netherlands, did that. That's not very nice, and it's how it is. So I'm just wondering how you look upon those things. What's been done to you? We're not gonna read them out, but you've been tortured, and I mean, 14 years as such already is enough torture. So how do you look upon the question of forgiving, forgiveness? You've written about it, but if you listen to Jochem ten Haaf reading out Simon Wiesenthal, what do you think on this?
You know, there are two kinds, you know, I agree with the part that I cannot forgive what is done to others, but I am as a global citizen, and Yuri, let's face it, in 100 years, they will not be the Netherlands, Mauritania, Germany, because we are global. You know, the other day I was in London, like in July and August, I was visiting. And when I came to the Heathrow, I was scared, I was shaking. Because this is my first time in more than 20 years in a Western country. And I know after 9/11, the rule of law is not always respected. And they asked me, a guy at the gate, of the plane asked me, are you European Union or American? Are you Moroccan? I was happy. I said, no, I'm not Moroccan. I said, I'm Mauritanian. He said, same thing, this side. And then I found myself with African, Indian people, Pakistani people, and all the European, like Americans and Canadian on one side. This reminded me of the Bible and Quran of Day of Judgment. Good people on one side, bad people on the other side. And to be honest to you, for the first time, I was happy to find myself among the bad people, you know? And you could see like, they sweat us at the border. What are you doing here? Okay, I'm doing this, that. Are you going to go back home? When are you going to go back home? I just arrived, dude. I don't know. And show us money, okay? And the European American, you know, playing with their smartphone, you know, they know they're coming in. They know they will not send them back. Yuri, this will not be accepted in 50 years. We will look at this kind of mistreatment for someone who has no crime except having been born in India, like slavery. We will look at this, cannot happen. And so I do believe that the Netherlands, you know, should always be a good friend to America. And a good friend to America is not always telling them, yes, they go, we take you to Iraq, do go with us. We bombard Iraq, we bombard Libya, we bombard Somalia, you come with us. No, Netherlands is maybe a small country in size, but a superpower in human rights. And that's what matters to me as a human being. And it's a shame that to this day, the Netherlands is welcoming the people who participated in torture and just killing the message. You know, they are not allowing. I mean, the least you can say that I have a narrative, a counter-narrative. I love this narrative to meet Dutch people and to share with them because this is what democracy. I mean, Frau Burgemeester said that, you know, we need to have the freedom, you know, to follow, you know, a doctrine or to be against that doctrine, even ridicule that doctrine. That's freedom. But why this freedom, why this big challenge when America violates human rights and everybody stops it? Okay, this is America, we have to take a step back. I don't think this is healthy for America. I think the Netherlands is better than that. And I only remind you of the Chilcot report, the war inquiry in the UK, they found out that it was not okay for the UK to follow the US in the war in Iraq.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You're right. I mean, we've talked about this just before. Your torturers are allowed to be here and travel the world. You're not. So the you're not free to go because Western countries still don't allow you to travel, and although you have no guilt and it's been proven, you're still not treated in the way the torturers of Guantanamo Bay and the perpetrators here in the Netherlands and in America are free to go where they want to go. And again, it's been done to you for 14 years, and you it continues, aren't you? By now, getting really angry about it and fed up?
No. I cannot accept to be defeated. I'm a very hard-headed person. And if I'm angry, you know, I love this saying, resentment and hate is like drinking poison and hoping that someone else dies. I'm not doing that. I know Netherlands has, partners, they listen to America, they listen to other countries. I understand that, but all I want to say is that Netherlands, I am your friend. I love you. I'm not here except to add to you. I'm not going to take away from you. I'm going to add to you because you are a place where I can say what I want, when I want. I can wear what I want. I can pray the way I want or not pray. This is like, to me, the closest thing to Nirvana. And that's all we can do as citizens, to, just bring our case and argue.
Thank you, Mohamadou. Thank you very much. I'm going to look at the audience and ask whether there are people to want to ask something or comment. Let's see whether there's anybody who... yes, please, the mayor of Amsterdam, Femke Halsema.
Thank you so very much for talking with us, and it's really impressive. But while I'm listening to you, I'm just wondering, what are you dreaming of? So what do you want to do the coming years?
So I want to work with the Bali. And I... contribute to this beautiful art of the Netherlands. I mean, and I want to be able to travel freely and share my story, because maybe for me it's too late, Frau Burgemeester, but for the young people in Africa and in the Middle East, I need to give them the example, and to show them that we can achieve our rights without violence. We can achieve everything we want without violence. And we can establish the same freedom that you have in the Netherlands in our countries, We want the same freedom in Iran that you have in the Netherlands. We want the same freedom in Africa and in the Middle East. That is not hard. We are not asking for money. We are not asking to be the president of the United States of America. We just want freedom. The same freedom that people enjoy,
Thank you. There's, I think, one woman in the back who wants to... And there's another woman over there in the green, I think. Yeah, there are two.
Thank you for sharing your story. What does justice mean to you?
Did you hear the question, Mohamadou?
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. justice, I mean, the perfect justice is that people like you and people in the Western world, the free world in general, understand that the young people in Africa and the Middle East, they want freedom, and you help us to achieve freedom. And this is the strategy, but on this low scale, is that people, war criminal are brought to justice. I don't want anyone to go to prison. I don't want money from them, but I just want young people everywhere to see that if you're powerful, you're still responsible. I give you an example. You know, Den Haag is where they have the international court, you know? And America, they tried to, several months ago, they tried to bring American war criminals, alleged war criminals, to the court. America was very stern, and they issued a very strong warning that anyone who is involved is going to be banned from the United States of America. They're going to be sanctioned. This court was shaking, you know? And then they said, we are not investigating the US anymore. This is not justice. This is not justice. If you can only bring African dictators, African autocrats, African war criminals to Den Haag, and you leave American people, that's fascism, not democracy.
The lady over there had the last question, I think. Yeah.
Hello. First of all, it's a very big honor to be able to talk to you, even though it's through a Zoom connection. Very unfortunate. I have a question as a young 24-year-old. What is something that you would like to advise to, especially the younger generation, in a world that is in like a world with such a big divide and a growing divide and so much injustice? What is something that you would like to tell us or maybe advise us to, for example, avoid the huge, huge and embarrassing mistake that happened to you personally?
I mean, I really, the short answer, I don't have an answer. But, you know, just sitting here and supporting people like Crusader of Freedom, like the Bali, and, you know, like who give for everyone, who give for me, who give for Muslim, Christian, non-religious, Jewish people, they give them the platform to speak as they want. And this is like very important. Freedom is very important. And the second thing, we need to get rid of terrorism as a crime. First, this is not agreed upon. Second, it's abused by dictators. This part of the world, all they need for political opponents is to call them terrorists. And then they destroy them. And in a democracy, philosophically, this cannot be a crime. You know, if you kill someone, everybody agrees you go to prison. And if you destroy, so we need to be very wary not to adapt this narrative of the oppressor. You know.
I think, Mohamedou Ould Slahi, we leave it at this for this moment. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. There's many things I need to rethink after speaking to you about myself. You're a shining example. It's an honor and a great experience to be talking to you. I'm sure we will be able to give each other a big hug in not too long from now. Here and start your artist in residency. I really hope that's going soon. We've been asking, many people have been asking the ministers responsible for it, even in person. I'm sure it will come. They're not answering, but they have to answer after a while because there's not any reason not to grant you a visa now. Formally, they said there's no, but they just keep silent because it's their power to do that, which is abuse of power in itself. Thank you very much, Masih Alinejad. Thank you very, very much, Femke Halsema, mayor of our town. Thank you very much for opening this and for we continue to do this next year and the year after. Old friends like Mariam Namazie and Chan Dundar, new friends like Masih. Thank you very much for being here, the public and the audience. For the first time in 11 years, our servers tonight were attacked. So you've been hearing this. The internet has not been seeing this. Our technicians tell us that it's not a coincidence that our servers being attacked from outside.
It's Iran.
Somebody obviously don't want the things he've been said here. by Mohammed Al-Tslahi, by Maz Elinejad, and by Femke Halsema to be heard in the world. It's the first time in 11 years. It's ironic that it's the opening of a free speech and free thinking conference, which is... thank you very much for being here. I hope we have a good drink. I need one.
Some of them.